Okay. We're here at the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad Visitor Center. And we're going to go in a minute. That must be Caitlin Jackson. There's a Caitlin Jackson here too. Okay. All right. Yep, it's me again. And we're heading over to the Visitor Center in a minute. Huh? I'm going to get hit?
No.
Oh, please.
It's the same turn that we did.
Okay, see? I'm not the only one that thought it. Okay. So, we're parked over here. And it's a pretty nicely designed area. All right, we're heading over to the building.
She was a hero. She was a general, and she was Moses.
If it wasn't for her, where would we be now? We look at Harriet Tubman and she gives us strength.
Her story certainly does not end with her exploits on the Underground Railroad.
Harriet Tubman is a model for many different generations.
You cannot be here and not talk about the trials that she had, the spirits that she had in God will make any person persuaded to doing great things in her life.
She is always demonstrating the value of the
Harriet Tubman game. Everything she had, and the only time her hand would be out and open was for somebody to give her something that would help somebody else.
She was a strong woman, and she was full of
Thank you.
That's right. I'll see that when I come back there. This is what your great-grandfather did. Emerson, this is the job he had.
Cutting down wood?
Cutting the trees down, notching the logs.
Okay.
And all the rest of that. This is what they got paid for.
Thank you. In the late fall of 1856, Tubman traveled to rescue her enslaved sister, Rachel, and Rachel's two children. But she was thwarted when Rachel refused to leave without them. Rachel's master separated her from her children, and she was unable to leave them. In order to make use of the trip, Tubman gathered another group of freedom seekers, Joe and Bill Baker, Peter Pendleton, and Eliza Lenoke. However, this race to freedom in Canada would be one of Tubman's most dangerous missions. Extraordinary rewards were offered for the return of the runaways: $1,500 for Joe Baker and $800 for Peter. In today's currency, those rewards totaled over $60,000. Many slave catchers hoped to secure a small fortune by capturing these valuable men. And the slave catchers had an advantage. Joe had a deep and identifiable scar on his face. This scar threatened his and his fellow fugitives' chances for freedom. Outpaced by the advertisements for their capture, Joe was depressed and sullen for most of the journey. The slave catchers' persistent traffic forced them to proceed slowly. They hid in root cellars and underground storage area for food, while slave catchers passed within feet of them. The group wore disguises in order to hide in plain sight. To try to avoid detection, they split up multiple times to regroup at the next station. They traveled on foot, by wagon, and by boat. These delays only increased the chances of capture. Nearly 2 weeks later, they were at the outskirts of Wilmington, Delaware. This trip ordinarily would have taken Tubman 3 or 4 days. When they finally arrived at the long bridge into Wilmington, it was lined with advertisements and guarded by police officers on the lookout for the freedom seekers. With great difficulty, they got word to Underground Railroad agent Thomas Garrett that they were unable to cross the bridge. Garrett engaged the services of a couple of black bricklayers. They located the hidden party and concealed them in a secret compartment in their wagon. After nightfall, the bricklayers crossed the bridge singing and shouting to create a distraction. They went undetected by the police and slave catchers. From there, the party traveled north by train toward Canada. As they crossed the bridge over the Niagara River, Tubman called out to refresh.